Good morning. It's Thursday, October the 21st, and this is The Drill. I'm Ron, your host, the only true conservative in the United States today, because I'm the only one that knows that there's more to life than politics. Welcome to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there today. The Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare, then the Pledge of Allegiance, Star-Spangled Banner, America the Beautiful, all that and much more when I come back. Thank you. And now the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare for October 21st. Walk in forgiveness. My heart longs to forgive your sins and withhold my judgment from you. I will be merciful to you when you cry to me, and I will bring joy to your soul, for I am good and ready to forgive, and abundant in mercy to all those who call upon me. From my dwelling place in heaven I will hear your prayers and supplications to me, and I will maintain your cause. I will forgive your sins and trespasses and grant compassion to you in the midst of your enemies. My eyes are open to your supplications, and my ears will hear you when you call. Prayer Declaration. God, I thank you that when you hear prayers, you also forgive us. Forgive me of my sins and have compassion upon me. Like the servant who owed the king 10,000 talents, I too have been forgiven much. Therefore, I will go and forgive all those who have sinned against me, so that I will not be given over to the tormentors. With your Son Jesus, I pray, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that was the Amen. And that was the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare for October 21st. Thank you. I'm going to make a recommendation of an excellent book to read, and it's called Medieval Answers to Modern Questions by Neil J. Smith. And this is a book in which he is fantasizing that he is sending questions back in the past, all the way back to medieval times, to St. Thomas Aquinas, and that St. Thomas Aquinas is going to write the answers to these questions on stone tablets and leave them buried for Mr. Smith's retrieval later on. So there's a series of 21 questions, and the St. Thomas Aquinas answers them in a debate style kind of format, and it's fascinating stuff. So there's the contents, there's the introduction, and question one is, does the state have a duty under natural law to provide medicine and medical services to citizens who cannot afford them? Question 2, does the state have the right under natural law to stop refugees from entering its borders? Question 3, does the state, which formerly permitted the holding of slaves, but after freeing them from rebel enslavers and enfranchising them, failed to compensate the freedmen fully, have a duty under natural law to make restitution for the property and labor stolen from the freedmen, even though the rebel enslavers and freedmen are long dead and the freedmen's descendants intermixed with those of the rebels? Question 4, is favoring affirmatively the tribe that comprises the majority of descendants of the freedmen in employment and university admission unjust? Question 5, the citizens of a state have a right under the natural law to keep and bear arms privately. Question 6, is it licit for the state to mandate citizens and their children to take vaccines against their will? Question 7, is changing a person's sex through physical transformation impossible? Question 8, should the state forbid attempts to change a person's sex by medical means? Question 9, is it unjust for the state to require by law one to address or refer to persons of one sex as if they are the other sex? Question 10, can social justice be regarded as a distinct species of justice? Question 11, does social justice not require equality of material wealth among different social orders? Question 12, is a state's constitution predicated on socialism, the doctrine that presupposes the collective ownership of all means of production and distribution of goods and services and the abolition of private property to create a uniform society, unjust? Question 13, is a state's constitution predicated on liberalism, the doctrine that proposes that all men are autonomous, rational, and equal, and that the state must ensure the absolute maximum amount of both individual liberty and equality, unjust? Question 14, is abortion evil? Question 15, is the use of marijuana and other intoxicating drugs not altogether evil? Question 16, is it evil to create artificial life and intelligence? Question 17, should alms be given in abundance to the poor? Question 18, do the unlawful acts of certain clergymen and the bishop's failure to prevent such acts fail to make the church itself unfaithful to Christ and unfit to dispense the sacraments? Question 19, is the consumption of meat permissible under the natural law? Question 20, must laborers be paid a minimum wage? Question 21, is it just to discharge an insolvent person's debt by declaration of bankruptcy in the courts of Vineland? So that is the table of contents for the book, Medieval Answers to Modern Questions by Neil J. Smith. So I recommend it, and I've read through some of the questions, and it goes very much in depth. So you have, let's look at the first one. If I can find it here, I have a long introduction. Question 1, does a state have a duty under natural law to provide medicine and medical services to citizens who cannot afford it? And it starts with objections, and then answers to the objections, and so it's laid out in a very easy to read and understand kind of format. So you get a chance, get this book, and it is on Kindle. And I'm not sure how much it costs. Let me see if I can find out here. No, doesn't say right here. So, but anyways, get this book, Medieval Answers to Modern Questions by Neil J. Smith. It's very, very much enlightening. There we go. Thank you, thank you. And now I'm going to be reading a selection from the book called Real Philosophy for Real People. To one familiar with the history of philosophy, especially philosophy in the modern and postmodern modes, it seems awfully unlikely that philosophy has much to offer anyone who wishes to identify the necessary requirements and resources available for securing a foundation that will allow us to build a moral house in which we would want to live. The forms of philosophy that are most common today seem to have little to contribute to a project of human flourishing. The problem, my mentor Paul Weiss told me frequently, is that philosophers let theories get in the way of what they and everyone else know. In other words, philosophers generate theories that deny how human beings actually live and reject what humans evidently know. There are professional philosophers who deny non-arbitrary morality, yet expect universities to honor their contracts. They question the existence of any reality outside the mind, yet correct the waiter when he brings the wrong order. They spurn tradition, but demand tenure. Paul Weiss used to tell a story to illustrate the irony and madness of such an approach to philosophy. Quote, an explorer came back from a safari in Africa. He told his friends of how he had been trapped in the jungle by wild animals. There I was, with tigers in front of me and tigers behind me, lions to the right and lions to the left. His friends asked him, what did you do? The explorer replied, what could I do? I was killed. Unquote. Like the explorer who lived to tell the story of his own death, many philosophers write and teach and love and make plans and raise children and cash checks, all the while assuring others how unsure we in fact must be about what can be known or what ought to be done. I say that philosophy can do better than that, hence the title of this book, Real Philosophy for Real People. And so what he's missing, the only thing that he's missing here is that he assumes that philosophers and philosophy have just sort of wandered off the path and accidentally gone the wrong direction. No, it's deliberate. This was started first by Descartes, and then after that by what is known as the Frankfurt School, which is a bunch of socialists and communists that got together to create philosophy and philosophies that support communism and socialism. So again, that was a clip or a little bit from the book, Real Philosophy for Real People. Thank you, thank you. So on a personal note, I am mounting a campaign, so to speak, on Twitter, on my podcast, and elsewhere to bring back Bryan Suits, or more specifically, bring back Hyperlocal Sunday and bring back his Saturday show. And he was on KFI. He was a broadcaster on KFI Saturdays and Sunday nights. He also was a substitute from time to time for other broadcasters who were on vacation and whatnot on KFI. And so the shows were like, I think, 8 to 10 on each day. And it was above average show. It was well worth listening to. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed what he had to say. He had a lot of insights. The biggest criticism I had of Mr. Suits was his cryptic approach. He's very often rather cryptic about things, and that makes it difficult to understand him. But other than that, both shows were entertaining. They were good. They were off the beat. They were just different than the standard fare. Usually, people are doing what they're doing on talk shows is telling you about the news and then doing commentary and analysis, such as it is. And with Bryan Suits, Mr. Suits would do a little bit. He did some commentary and analysis. Most of his commentary and analysis and news had to do with things military. He was a former captain in the United States Army, and he was involved in combat and whatnot. So he a brave guy, and so again, and because of where he went, what he did, he had a lot of insights, and things that you didn't hear about on other radio shows or other news sources. He had, again, kind of the insights, the behind-the-scenes kind of situation. So one day, anyways, he's gone. He's not on the air anymore. No explanation, no nothing. And I hate it when stations do that. They'll just drop somebody and they won't explain. They won't tell anybody, look, we've separated, parted company. That show is no longer going to be on. We're going to substitute it with a new show. So because every weekend I'm looking for Bryan Suits, I figured, well, maybe he's on vacation or whatever, that this is a temporary vacancy or void or lapse, however you care to describe it. And so I've been following him on Instagram, and so somebody had apparently asked him what happened, and he announced on Instagram to all of his followers that he had been fired. So no explanation, as you know, again, typical cryptic Mr. Suits. He leaves it at that, drops the bomb, and then walks away. And one of his Instagram followers, because I had made some sort of a comment about it, and one of his followers then contacted me and said that they had contacted one of the program managers at KFI to voice their complaint. And that's where I got the idea of mounting the campaign to bring him back. Again, if he had the person or the show that they replaced him with is just awful. There's no other way to describe it. It's just awful. And if they had replaced him with something better, then I wouldn't bother. Because again, this is about content. It's about me as a listener and what it is that I'm going to have to listen to on Saturdays and Sundays. And rather than I'm doing this because I'm trying to help out Bryan Suits, help him get back on the air or, you know, get him out of the unemployment line or whatever else. I don't care about that. I don't care whether he comes, stays, lays, or prays. That's his problem. My problem is, what do I listen to on Saturday and Sunday besides the dreck that's being offered by KFI? So I'm mounting that campaign, and I'm going to be doing it on Twitter. And I'm not only going to mount this campaign to send these tweets to KFI, but also to their sponsors. I find that it's much more effective if you're going to complain to a radio station or to a radio personality that you also complain, include their sponsors when you make that tweet or complaint. Much better that way. So, and that's what I'm going to be doing. And I'm going to do it on my podcast as well. At the end of the podcast, when I, after the singing of America the Beautiful, then I will remind everybody and say, return Bryan Suits, or I may just say, bring back The Dark Secret Place, which was his Saturday program, and Hyperlocal Sunday. So, because I really don't care who hosts it as much as long as it remains true to format. I don't care who hosts it. It could be Bryan Suits. It could be The Man in the Moon. So, anyways, yeah, that's a little personal aside. And so you'll be hearing that on a regular basis, hearing me at the end of the broadcast saying, bring back either Bryan Suits or bring back The Dark Secret Place. Thank you. That was gorgeous. And so I, again, bring back Bryan Suits, bring back The Dark Secret Place, bring back Hyperlocal, Super Hyperlocal Sunday. And I also want to remind everybody, I've got a book out. It's called, a companion book's called The Drill. So it's a companion book to this broadcast or podcast. And so it's $2.99 at the Kindle bookstore. Buy the book. And you can also, I do believe you can download, if you're not sure you want to buy it, download a sample. You can read an excerpt of it and decide. Also, if you're Kindle Unlimited, you can read it for free. So I have I'm doing this, the way I'm doing this book is it's going to be in editions. So this is the first edition. Second edition is due out the middle of next month. And I am seriously considering for the next edition is that I'm going to put out the second edition is going to be strictly recommended reading. I'm seriously considering doing that rather than the other content, save the other content for a subsequent edition. But in any case, that's due out in the middle of November. And so until next time, be honest, be smart, be beautiful, and remember that the left has no authority, no power, and they can't win.